control. And so now we come to chapter 25. And they had attempted to curse God's people. God wouldn't allow it. Balaam pronounced the truth, blessed God's people. Spirit of God came upon him. And now we come to chapter 25. And as we come to chapter 25, I want to just say this too, that I titled the message, So Close and Yet So Far. So close and yet so far. There are so many people that are so close to believing the truth and yet will allow themselves to miss heaven by 18 inches. What I mean by that is the distance between their head and their heart. They have a belief that there is a God, but they won't surrender their life to Him. And there's a lot of people, I believe in God. I had my Muslim customer that we talked about on Sunday. I had him this morning, spent a couple hours with him, talking to him about the Lord. We have very good conversations. He's very gracious, and so, you know, we try to be loving toward each other. And here's this man who's so devout and so wrong. And you can be devout and you can be zealous and be wrong. You can believe it with all your heart and you can believe a lie. And sadly, we're going to see in tonight's text that there's going to be these people that are so close. One, first of all, Balaam was so close to the truth and yet so far away. He had the Spirit of God poured out upon him. He interacted with Jesus Christ, saw him face to face and talked with him when he was riding on the donkey. So he's had these interactions. And so you can even have, you know, hear how the Lord speaks to you and still reject him. And sadly, that's what they did. Now, the generation we're looking at going forward after tonight is this generation that they too, so close and yet so far, if they're not careful. Because here they are on the outskirts of the land of promise. God has called them to enter in. God's got a plan for their lives. You know, this is the generation. They've been delivered out of bondage in Egypt. So the younger generation, some of them have been born in the wilderness, but some of them, anybody that was young, you know, in their teenage years, they remembered Egypt. They remembered Christ. If you're 10 years old and you walk through the Red Sea, I'm thinking you remember that. Amen? I think if the sea opens up and you walk through and it swallows up, yeah, you remember that. If you're 10, 12, 13 years old and you're Mount Sinai and God speaks, you remember that. And when God's dropping manna out of the sky, you remember that. And when the pillar of fire and the pillar of cloud is leading the way, you remember that. And when God gives you victory over the enemies, you remember that. So it's not like this generation hasn't been exposed to the truth. They have. And now it's their turn to enter in. It's their turn to be the ones to obey God. They would also remember that Miriam murmured against God's people, against God's Moses, and she was covered with leprosy. They also remember, no doubt, when the serpents came into the camp, remember, and bit the people, and they all started to die, and the bronze serpent was held up. They remember all of that, but now it's their opportunity. Guys, we can know the history, but do you have a relationship with the Lord? Amen? And here they are. They're just there. They're just on the outskirts of the camp. It's time to, we're going to be going into God's place. And now Balaam, we're going to see Balaam one more time. Because this guy is a greedy, money-hungry man. And even though he was unable to curse him, he's going to come up with another plan to stumble God's people. And God is going to deal with Balaam. So if you have your outline, grab it. Let's go through it quickly. We'll dig into the text. So if you have your outline, so I tell the message, so close and yet so far. First of all, we're going to see that sin has consequences. Amen to that? Amen. The Bible says the way of the transgressor is hard. One of my youngest son's best friends since he was 2 years old, we just found out yesterday that he had been dating this younger girl, and he's not walking with the Lord. He'd been dating this younger girl, and this younger girl sent him a picture of herself with no top on by phone. And the police showed up at his house yesterday and they arrested, because her parents saw it. He's a little over 18 and she's a little under 18. And now he's on the front page of all the news channels for child pornography. And his family's going through it. I reached out to his parents today to tell him I'm praying for him. Now, certainly this is consequences of sinful behavior. Amen? If you were not doing this, you wouldn't be where you are. But now he's going to be labeled as a sexual predator the rest of his life. Guys, let's obey God. It's better. Amen? The way the transgressor is hard. So sin has consequences. And guys, as we walk in intimate fellowship with the Lord and seek to live lives in the center of His will, we must be prepared as temptations and the enemy's attacks are going to increase. As you walk with the Lord, temptation doesn't go away. Amen? And the enemy will try to find the area where you are weak, and he will tempt you with that. We're going to see that tonight. He's gonna find the area where these guys have witnessed so much of God. What's the one thing we can do to stumble the young men? We're going to see that in tonight's text. And we're going to see with God's promises and presence among those encamped in, as they're headed to the land of promise, it's still going to fall, and many of these men of God are going to succumb to the flesh. And sadly, there's nothing new under the sun because it still happens today. Amen? Aren't you shocked when you see somebody that you know is a Christian, that you know has been walking with the Lord, their life has borne fruit for some period of time, and then all of a sudden you find out they left their family for somebody else, or they got addicted to drugs, or they got arrested for stealing from their company, or something crazy happens, because none of us is above it. Amen? Take heed lest ye fall. We're going to see that in tonight's text. They're going to willfully succumb to temptation and enter into open sexual sin and idolatry. Now, point number two, so close and yet so far, sin has consequences. Point number two is taking a stand for the truth. Can I encourage all of us? I pray that as we go through this message, that we're all exhorted and encouraged to be unashamed of our faith in Jesus Christ and to take a stand for holiness in a world that wants nothing to do with holy living. Amen? Guys, we're salt and light. We're called to be different than the world. All you need to do is look at the people running for president to figure out that this place needs more of God. Amen? And we need to live holy and set apart lives and be Christ-like examples to a lost and a dying world. We must not turn a blind eye to open sin within the church. We're going to see that in tonight's text, and sometimes I think we do that. We get in a place now, look, there's two extremes. You can be so legalistic that you're a busybody sticking your nose in everyone's life. You're not supposed to do that. Amen? I got to worry about my own walk. How about you? That being said, we should love each other enough that if you see me in open rebellion against God, I would hope you would love me enough to come and pull me aside and talk to me. Amen? And guys, the easiest thing to do is ignore it and act like it's no big deal. And you know what happens when you do that? The church gets corrupted, and that's what we're seeing in the world today. Amen? Churches where the gospel's being watered down, holy living is antiquated, live and let live, do what you want. Hey, guys, let's obey God. Amen? So taking a stand for the truth and holiness, guys, if we want our homes, our families, and our children to be blessed, to be zealous for God, to live a sincere and passionate life, we must take action to take sin out of the camp. So sin has consequences, taking a stand for the truth, and then finally, God suffers long, but he won't suffer always. While he desires that none should perish, at some point, those who reject him over and over and over are going to reap the consequences of their choices. And guys, there before the grace of God is every one of us. Amen? So let's begin there in verse 1, that sin has consequences. So close and yet so far, beginning with sin has consequences. Let's begin there in verse 1. Now Israel remained in Acacia Grove. Some of yours have Shittim. Anybody have Shittim in their Bible? Okay, Shittim, that word means, it's the type of wood that grew that they used to build the tabernacle with. So this is very precious wood that they use to build the tabernacle. It's where they would go and harvest that wood. And this is the final campground before they enter the land of promise. They're about to cross over the Jordan River and go into the land that God had promised them 40 years before, and they're in camp just outside the land. They can look across the river, and there's the land of promise. There it is. They're so close to God's 40 years of wandering in the wilderness. It's about to come to an end. We're right there. We can see it from where we're standing. And guys, as you surrender your life fully to the Lord and you're pressing into the kingdom of God and you're starting to be used for the Lord and you're sharing your faith and you're using your gifts, the enemy, as you're getting closer to the Lord, the enemy's going to want to do anything he can to derail you. And that's what's going to happen in tonight's text. As they're so close to entering in, one last try from the enemy to derail them and get their eyes off of God's promises and to cause them to fall into sin, to be disqualified from entering into the land. The name Shittim also means thorns. And we know that thorns and thistles came into existence in Genesis after Adam and Eve sinned. And we also know that Jesus had a crown of thorns placed upon his head, and thorns are a representation of sin. So here they are in this place of sin, heading into the land of promise and all that God has for them, and the enemy doesn't want them to leave. And the enemy doesn't want you to leave. If you're living a sinful life, if you've got an undercover life that only you know about, God knows about it. And if you're living a life of hidden sin, and if you're living a life away from the Lord, the enemy wants to just keep you right where you are. And if you start pressing into the things of God, the enemy's going to do everything he can to trip you up, to cause you to go back to that old way of life, to draw you back again into the area where you are tempted. This is the final place, and the enemy has one more temptation for the camp. Balaam, who was unable to curse Israel, is driven by greed and covetousness. He's going to come up with a new plan. It says in Numbers 31, we'll get there in a few weeks. Look, these women caused the children of Israel, through the counsel of Balaam, to trespass against the Lord. Here's his new plan. I couldn't curse them. God wouldn't let me. So I knew what I'm going to do. I'm going to send a bunch of women into the camp, and they'll draw all the guys away. I'm going to send some harlots into the camp, and they're going to take these men who at this moment are pursuing God and are following the cloud, and they're, you know, wherever God moves, they move. We'll all bring some distractions in to draw them away from God. And what happens is they're going to be drawn away not only to these women, but to the gods that these women serve. And so the enemy knows what your weak spot is. And if he's going to tempt you, and I've said this before, you know, I have three sons who've struggled with drug addiction. I'm very transparent about that. And they're in varying places in their recovery from that. But that's never, I've got my own problems, but that's not my problem. And that's why it's so hard for me to, I don't get it. I've told people, you could put 500 pounds of cocaine in my driveway, leave it there for a year, not going to be a problem for me. It's just not. You can leave kegs of every kind of alcohol. You can put the rarest whiskey in my backyard. I would just be getting a shovel, throwing it away. It's not a problem. Now, I have my own problem, but that's just not one of them. So the enemy's not going to tempt me with drugs or alcohol, because, you know, that's not an issue for me. But he knows what our weaknesses are, and that's what he will tempt you with. And these bunch of young men, they're all under 40, amen? So they're young men, and these young men are going to be the ones, well, some are a little over 40, right? But they're all young men, and they're going to have women thrown in front of them. And that's going to be a temptation. And it's going to draw these guys away. In Revelation 2, addressing the church of Pergamos, the compromising church, Jesus said this, I have a few things against you because you have those here who would hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to put a stumbling block before the children of Israel to eat things sacrificed to idols and to commit sexual adultery or sexual immorality. Balaam suggested to Balak that the Moabites and the Midianites convene a religious feast to honor Baal and to invite all the Jews to attend. And when they did, they would then take an opportunity to bring the women out to draw them away. First of all, they should have nothing to do with a feast honoring Baal. Amen? Hey, we're having a rage here. We're having this party, and this is what we're doing. As a Christian, if it's not a place you would take Jesus, don't go. Now, we go minister to the world, and we love everybody, and we're not better than anybody else, one beggar leading another beggar to the bread. But that being said, we don't need to, you know, abide in their entertainment or get involved with the things that they do to reach them. And so that's what's going to happen. And Baal worship, and we'll move on in a minute, but Baal worship, part of it involved temple prostitutes. So part of their worship was to sleep with prostitutes. That would probably be a pretty popular church right about now. I think you could get guys to sign up for that. Hey, we got a bunch of beautiful women. You can come have sex with them. Come to our church. You might get it. We probably have a line around the building. That's sad. It's tragic because people are moved by the flesh and not by the spirit. And part of Baal worship was the sacrificing of children. Because he was the god of rain and the god of fertility, and if they wanted it to rain, they would sacrifice children, and what they would do is they would heat up his arms, and then they would take the babies and set him on this, you know, hot metal, and the babies would be burned alive. And we all think, that is disgusting, and it is, amen? But you know what? We're not far from it, Because the reason that they had so many babies is they had sexual immorality as a part of their worship. So all these pregnancies were happening that weren't happening, you know, in a husband and wife situation. It wasn't a family. So they would just take the babies. They were no value. So today, instead, what we do is we abort the babies. And, you know, a lot of the babies are killed by being burnt alive. There's a solution that's put into the woman's womb that kills them, much like the babies being burnt alive. So we look at Baal worship and say how archaic. Guess what? We're just as archaic today. Amen? Amen? And we don't kill babies because of the sins of the parents. Amen? So this is tragic. And what was Balaam's motive? It says in 2 Peter, they have forsaken the right way and gone astray, following the way of Balak, the son of Beor, who loved the wages of unrighteous. Balaam's motive was greed and covetousness, the love of money, and that's why the people are going to find themselves in this mess. Look what it says here. The people began to commit harlotry with the women of Moab. So close. We're right here. There it is, the land of promise. We're going to cross over the river. We're going to be in the land flowing with milk and honey. All that God promised. He's going to give us victory in the land. His presence is going to be upon us. We're so close. And what in the world would cause someone so close to God's highest to turn away? They're going to be tempted with harlotry. Satan knows what their weakness is. And I want to say this. Since the beginning, this is the beginning of one of the greatest downfalls. And since the beginning of time, sexual immorality is one of Satan's greatest tools. Amen? Amen? And here's the sad part. It's becoming almost acceptable in the church. And we're shocked when people wait until they're married to have physical intimacy. Amen? When my daughter married my son-in-law, I've told you this story. When I said you may kiss the bride, it was the first time they had ever kissed anybody in their life, including each other. And they waited. And people to this day still go, come on, man, that's not real. That didn't really happen. Yeah, it did. Can God do that? Amen? Just remember, ladies, what you use for bait will determine what you catch. Amen? And if you want a man who only cares about your body, just use your body to get him. And then when he only cares about your body, don't be shocked. A man, God's man, will respect you, he will protect you, and he will wait and do it in a godly fashion. And if he doesn't and your dad's not around, I'll talk to him. Amen? I'm going to have to get back in the gym just to be yoked enough to talk to these knuckleheads. But guys, sexual immorality is not okay. It's one man with one woman for a lifetime. Be faithful in your marriage. Amen? Some of you have felt the bad side of that, where your spouse was unfaithful, and you know how harmful that is, not only to you and your marriage, but your children. Amen? So here's the sexual immorality. That's what the enemy is going to use. And is it not true? Look, sexual immorality always leads to more sin, by the way. Amen? Look at some of the men of God who struggled. King David, man after God's own heart, did he struggle with sexual sin? What's the answer? Bathsheba. But why was he with Bathsheba? You know why? Because he wasn't out fighting the battle when he was supposed to be. He used to lead them into battle. Now he became the comfortable king. He's sleeping all day, getting up in the noonday sun and looking out, sees a nude woman and takes her and then has her husband murdered. King Solomon, did he have a woman problem? When you've got four digits of women, you're over 1,000 between wives and concubines. Dude, I think he probably tried to marry people twice. Get her for me. Oh, dude, you've been married to her already. Really? That's what, okay. I mean, 1,015, I mean, good grief. It's tragic. Abraham. Hey, Abraham, thanks for the whole Hagar thing, because now we got the Middle East. Amen? Thanks for sleeping with the maidservant, because how's that working out? Amen? Guys, God's way is best. God's way is highest. So the harlots are going to come into the camp. Couldn't curse them. Let's just send a bunch of young women in there and let them draw the guys away. That's a word for every man in the room. If you're not married, amen? It's still an epidemic. Sexual immorality running rampant. And I know I'm spending time a lot on verse 1, but we're going to get deeper into this. But I want to say this. I've been a pastor for almost 30 years. 15 of that, I did men's ministry between Lancaster, San Jose, and then briefly at Godspeak. And do you know the number one thing that men would confess? I mean, Christian men married love God. And they would come and share their heart with me. And the number one thing that I would hear when they would confess to me is they were struggling with pornography. And one of the reasons that it's so bad today is some of the same men who would never go into a strip club if you paid them $10,000 because somebody might see them walking in or walking out. Amen? But at home, or on your phone, or on your iPad, or on your computer when everybody's asleep, every kind of good thing's available and everything of evil is available to come right into your house. Amen? And I want to encourage you, get a filter on your phone, get a filter on your iPad, and get a filter on your computer that blocks out all that nasty stuff that you don't need to see. Amen? Make the decision to honor God. And so, verse 2, notice what happens. In verse 2, they invited the people to the sacrifices of their gods, and the people ate and bowed down to their gods. These guys went from worshiping and following the true and living God, again, saw the Red Sea part, heard the voice of God from Mount Sinai, manna falling from the sky, the pillar of fire and the pillar of cloud leading every step, the temple, the tabernacle, being right in the center of the people, God's presence being there, and they're remaining faithful to God in the midst of all of this, and what leads them away? The women came into the camp, and now they're willing to go hang out and make sacrifices to an idol. Guys will do anything for a woman. Amen? A church in Santa Cruz got really big, and I'd see guys show up, and I knew. That guy right there, I'm going to talk to him. And I'd see these guys, and they'd be all over some girl from our church, and I'd go, hey, bro, what's your name, man? I'd talk to him. Where are you at with the Lord? Tell me, share your testimony, bro. I want to hear how you got saved. They got nothing. But they're a church. Because I got invited to church by a pretty girl. And the pretty girl thinks he loves Jesus. No, he doesn't. You could say, I'm going to the Church of Satan. You want to go? Uh-huh. Yeah, I'll go. I'm Mormon. Sure, I can be a Mormon. I can be a Mormon for you. Yeah, I can do. Guys will do anything. And these guys right here get lured into sacrificing to Baal. They're sacrificing to a false god. They're turning their back on the true and living God for women they just met. This is not agape, this is eros, amen? This is not love, this is lust. And they're being drawn away. They've been joined physically to these women, and after that it was so easy to accept their invitation to idol worship. Sin and compromise and unrepentance leads to greater sin. Have you ever noticed you don't go from on fire for God to cheating on your wife? You don't go from on fire for God, getting strung out on heroin, amen? You don't go from on fire for God to cheating, stealing. Guys, you take one step away. It's one little compromise that leads to another compromise, and all of a sudden you find yourself at the feet of Baal worshiping a false god. Amen. And Baal's the god of fertility. And so right now, if you put physical intimacy with a man or a woman above your relationship with God, you've got a false god that needs to die. Amen? I know it's easier said than done, but be careful. So unbelievable, so close to the land of promise. These children of Israel are sacrificing to false gods. They're eating things offered to idols. They're bowing down and worshiping Baal. They're breaking the first two commandments. Thou shalt have no other gods before me, and thou shalt serve no graven image. And they heard God speak this from, and the tablets came down. Here they are. They're written down for you. They know the commandments, and they're disobeying because they're being drawn away by the desires of their flesh. It says in James 1, but every man is tempted when he is drawn away by his own lust and enticed. And then when lust is conceived, it brings forth sin. And sin, when finished, brings forth death. How do we have victory over temptation? Who is tempted today? Okay. And if you were hands on up, you just weren't paying attention because you were. Amen. So temptation comes, And I try to remind people, like my boys who struggle with drugs, they get tempted to do drugs. They'll run into somebody they used to do drugs with, and there's temptation there. And I tell them, I've told you, and I'll tell you again, I remind myself of this daily. Temptation isn't only a chance to fall, it's a chance to grow. Amen? Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. So when temptation comes, if you turn from the enemy and the temptation to the Lord, you're growing through that. So temptation isn't necessarily completely bad, because it's a chance for me to grow. But how do you have victory? Galatians 5:16 says, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Amen? You know what? The enemy would say, if Satan had commandments, one of them would be, skip your devotions this morning, you're too tired, sign Satan. Amen? If you don't spend time with the Lord to begin your day, watch how your day goes. Amen? If you spend time with the Lord, you begin your day with the Lord, you spend time in prayer, you're seeking after God, it's amazing how your priorities, your passions, and your perspective on everything that goes on the rest of the day changes as you walk in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen? Walk in the Spirit, and you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Verse 3. So Israel was joined to Baal of Peor. How does God feel about that? And the anger of the Lord was aroused against Israel. These are God's chosen people. He has delivered them out of bondage. He has a plan for them. He wouldn't let Balaam curse them, but now his anger is aroused against them because they have turned against him. Because guys, they're committing harlotry in two ways. They're not only having sexual immorality physically, they're cheating on God with a false god. Amen? We're the bride of Christ. Amen? And since we're married to the Lord, we're God's bride, we're a part, you know, he's the groom and we're the bride, the church is his bride. And when we turn to a false god, it's spiritual infidelity. Amen? So here they're playing the harlot in two ways, physically and now with Baal. And God is stirred up because he loves his children. He has a heart for them, but when they go to serve a false god, they've turned their back on the true and living God. After all that he has done, he's got a land of promise prepared for them. It's right in front of them. Guys, God has gone away to prepare a place for us. It's right in front of us, amen? And it's so easy, if we're not careful, to get our eyes off of the eternal and set it on the physical and turn our backs on God. That's exactly what's happening with the children of Israel. The Bible says, if God is for us, who can be against us? Conversely, if God is against you, who can be for you? If God's anger is aroused against you, you don't want that. Amen? Yeah, I don't want that. I'd rather have all the mafia people mad at me. Everybody wants to kill me. I want the whole world to despise me, but not God hating me. I don't know. I'm good with God being angry with me, not so much. And now here's Israel. Like that. Women in the camp followed them out, committed harlotry, bowing down to the false god, and God looks down at Israel, who are encamped in the cross, and now he's grieved at them because they've gone away from the cross and they've gone into false worship of the false gods. When we leave the cross and go after false gods, we're arousing the anger of the God who loves us. You know what this is? This is the golden calf of the second generation. Amen? Remember the first generation had the golden calf around Mount Sinai? This is golden calf part two. This is the golden calf of the next generation. Nothing new under the sun, amen? And they're falling into the exact same trap. And guess what? The consequences are going to be just as heavy. The word angered in Hebrew, it really means angered and saddened. You could even use the term heartbroken. So when God sees his children walking away from him to pursue a false god and to commit harlotry, his heart is broken because he loves you. Amen? It just breaks my heart thinking about breaking his heart. Amen? I don't want to break my Savior's heart after all that he's done for me, all that he's done for you. Verse 4, watch the consequences. Here they come. Then the Lord said to Moses, take all the leaders of the people and hang the offenders before the Lord out in the sun, that the fierce anger of the Lord may turn away from Israel. Did you read that verse? You want me to read that one more time? Then the Lord said, take all the leaders of the people and hang the offenders before the Lord out in the sun, that the fierce anger of the Lord may turn away from Israel. The only way that there is going to be restoration with God is not only repentance for Israel, but righteous judgment upon those who would not repent. God suffers long, but he won't suffer always. Amen? So he says, literally, take them out and hang them in the fierce sun so everyone can see. Let this be an example of what happens when we disobey God. Now, people read verses like this and they're like, I don't like that God. I don't like him. That Old Testament God's kind of rough. I like that New Testament Jesus. It's the same God. Amen. Amen? Do you think that he likes doing this? It breaks his heart. But at the same time, if this sin is not dealt with, it will continue and grow and destroy them all. Amen? Guys, if we ignore sin, it doesn't go away. If we don't address it, it doesn't just make itself better on its own. Guys, we need to love each other enough to be transparent with each other when we're sinning and to reach out to people when we see them in sin. Amen? And so God says, hang the offenders, a public spectacle to God's judgment upon immorality and idolatry. The Bible says in James 1, let not many of you become teachers, knowing that you will face stricter judgment. Notice who got hung. It was the leaders. It was those who were the leaders of the people who had gone out and participated. He said, you take those leaders and you put them out. And you let everybody see that just because you held a position of authority doesn't mean your sin is okay. It's not okay. If anything, you're going to be held to a higher level of accountability. As a matter of fact, take the leaders and hang them out in the noonday sun so that the wrath of God may turn away from the children of Israel, and that all God's people will see that nobody can turn their back on God and not face judgment. Nobody can commit harlotry just because they have a position of authority and not face the wrath of God. Amen? Every man in a pulpit in America today ought to read this verse every morning. Amen? Take the leaders out, string them up. So everybody can walk by and go, that's what happens when you, yeah, I'm not doing that. Amen? The way of the transgressor is hard. That the fierce anger of the Lord may turn away. What turns away the fierce anger of the Lord? Righteous judgment upon sin. Verse 5. So Moses said to the judges of Israel, every one of you kill his men who were joined to Baal of Peor. The leaders were hung, and then those who had not offended had to go out and take their own people and put them up. The leaders were called to be the ones who brought the judgment to the people, and they were held to a stricter judgment themselves. So the leaders are held to a stricter judgment, but this is the part about being a leader that is no fun. Because some people think, oh, you're a pastor. You just work an hour a week, right? You just get up on Sunday and teach for an hour. I'd like to work an hour a week. That's pretty sweet. Well, there's 40 hours of studying, and then you're teaching twice a week, and then you have a full-time job, so not so much. But what I want you to see here is that the leaders are also accountable to make sure that those who had disobeyed God were righteously judged. They had to carry it out. Let me tell you, as a pastor, that's the least favorite thing I like to do. I'd rather just teach the Bible and hug everybody. But there are times when you have to discipline people in love, but bring the righteous judgment of God. So the leaders would be hung, but also the leaders would have to bring their own people and bring them out to be facing the righteous judgment of God. And a leader who didn't do that was not going to be a leader anymore. Let not many of you be teachers. It's not always fun. It's not always easy. Amen? But we have to be faithful to the Word of God and not worrying about being popular with men. If I ever am more worried about what you think of me than being faithful to God, fire me. Amen? Because that's not what needs to happen. And so these leaders, while accountable for their own sin, if they were guilty, they'd be hung. But so too, they had to carry it out with all of those that were, you know, you're in my tribe and my family. You're of my, you know, of the tribe of Judah. Then I'm going to have to be the one to take my own family that went out and worshiped Baal, and I have to be the one to call them out and recognize them and execute the righteous judgment upon them. So the leaders faced stricter judgment for their own behavior, and then they had to be in a task of carrying out God's judgment upon those who had fallen away. The judges, 70 chosen to assist Moses in governing, were to put the guilty under their charge to death. And again, sin results in death and separation, so close and yet so far. Can you imagine these guys are hanging in the fierce day sun, and depending on which way they're looking right into the land of promise. I could have been there. Instead, I'm going to die here. Because I didn't obey God and reap the blessings of obedience, now I'm reaping the consequences of disobeying God. This is heavy stuff, amen? New people are like, this church is kind of radical for me. I'm not so sure about this. They were put to death, and they missed out on the land of promise because they succumbed to their flesh's desires. When your flesh draws you away, it will never end well. Amen? By the way, your flesh will never be satisfied. Amen? I don't care how many times you give it what it wants, you're only going to want more of it. So point number one, so close and yet so far, sin has consequences. Point number two, taking a stand for the truth. So this is all going on, and now there's going to be a man by the name of Phinehas who's going to step up and take a stand for the truth. Look what happens. And indeed, one of the children of Israel came and presented to his brethren a Midianite woman in the sight of Moses, in the sight of all the congregation of the children of Israel who were weeping at the door of the tabernacle of meeting. So there were those who were so grieved by what happened, and then they were coming to the tabernacle meeting, and they were weeping and crying out to God because they had seen what had happened to God's people, and also because some of them, no doubt, their family members had been put to death. And so their hearts are broken to see what's happened in the camp. Their hearts are broken that people have walked away from God and they're worshiping Baal. Their hearts are broken that God's judgment has come upon them, just like the golden calf when the ground opened up and swallowed people. Here's the righteous judgment of God. Their hearts are broken. They're weeping. And here comes this man. And we're going to see he's one of the Simeonites. He's referred to as a prince of the Simeonites. So he's one of the leaders in the Simeonite tribe, and he's going to walk in with his harlot right into the camp where others, they had gone away into their camp or were committing adultery. He just brought her back with him and walked right into the camp. Got me a Midianite woman right here. Brought her right into, and you know what? Here's the scary part. This happens. The church that couple, without getting too much detail, because I'm not talking about an individual, there's nobody here, so you don't have to worry about it, but in Santa Cruz, I had a guy at church who committed adultery and cheated on his wife and then left his wife for another woman and then brought the other woman to church. His wife's sitting over here with her kids and he shows up and he's sitting right there. Comes and sits in the front row. I had a hard time concentrating. I'm like teaching and I'm just, let me get through this message. We're going to talk. Because I'm like, you got to be kidding. And it was like he paraded her in. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Found me a younger model. Left my wife and kids sitting in the front row at church. The last time he did that. But when I saw this, I thought about that. I'm like, really, bro? Because he's like, well, me and my wife weren't getting along, and, I want to bring her to church. You hypocrite. Amen? And the reality is that this guy walks into the camp where they're worshiping the Lord, where God's presence dwells, and he marches in with this harlot. And he's committed harlotry with her, and he's worshiped her false god, and now he just walked into the camp like it's okay with God. And watch what happens. Tell me the Bible wouldn't make a great movie. Amen? Leaders have been hung. Idolaters have been slain. People mourning and grieving and repenting. The gory, brutal sight. Blood is running. In the midst of it all, here comes the prince of the tribe of Simeon with his harlot. So people hanging. Blood's been shed. People have been put to death. Some people believe the leaders, only the leaders were hung and the others were put to death by the other leaders and they were just slain. But however it happened, there's blood in the camp and people have died and they've been made a spectacle of and everybody sees it and everybody knows it and this guy just walks in like it is no big deal. Watch what happens. Verse 7 and 8. Now when Phinehas, the son of Eleazar, so who's Eleazar? And he's the son of Aaron. So this is Aaron's grandson. So he's been raised, although his grandpa made the golden calf, but he's been raised having been taught the truth. So he knows, and look what happens. It says there in verse 7. Now when Aaron, the son of Eleazar, the son of Aaron the priest, saw it, he rose from among the congregation and took a javelin in his hand. I wonder what he's going to do with that. Verse 8, and he went after the man of Israel into the tent and thrust them both through, the man of Israel and the woman through her body, so the plague was stopped among the children of Israel. Now, I don't want to be too graphic, but for the javelin to go through both of them in their tent, they were probably mixing it up. And he walks in and sees them continuing in this behavior, and he throws a javelin through them. Is he in trouble? We'll find out in a second. Because it says there, because he dealt with the sin in the camp, that there was sin in the camp no longer. If sin is not dealt with, it becomes the way of life in the camp. Amen? And if everybody in the church is sleeping around, everybody in the church is getting drunk, and everybody in the church is being entertained by the things of the world, and everybody in the church is living a life of compromise, and they're Christians for an hour and a half on Sunday, and they go live like the world the rest of the week, don't be surprised when a lukewarm church has no impact on the world around it, and it's fruitless. Amen? There's a call to live holy lives. And he throws a javelin to this man. He never even saw it coming, more than likely. Right through him. God's not going to be mocked, amen? He impales him. Moses had commanded that they slay the transgressors, didn't he? He said, slay the transgressors. The word came from God, slay the transgressors. This transgressor's right in the camp, went right into his tent and took care of it. Boy, if this was the first chapter you ever read in the Bible, you'd be like, whoa, this is gnarly. He's God of love and grace and mercy. Amen? He suffers long, but not forever. We must never take sin lightly. Guys, while we live under God's grace and we are to supernaturally love one another, we're not to take a blind eye to those who would be counted as believers who openly flaunt their sin. Amen? Now, we're not going to be selling javelins in the back of the church. We're not going to have javelins with Calvary Chapel Calabasas on the site. We're not doing that. But what we have is Matthew 18. Matthew 18 says, if your brother is in sin, and you know it, in love, not gossip, go to your brother and confront him. And if he says to you, I don't care what you say, I'm going to do it anyway. Go pound sand, bro. And I'm going to keep coming to church, and if I want to do this, I'm going to keep doing it. Well, then you get another brother who's witnessed this behavior, and the two of you go together. Bro, we love you. You're headed in the wrong direction. Because we love you, we want to see you repent. Remember, the confrontation isn't for destruction, it's for restoration. Church discipline is to restore people, not to destroy people. Amen? The Bible then says, if he will not receive those two people, you bring him in front of the church and you tell the whole church. He's disfellowshipped. Now, have any of you ever seen that happen in your life? Anybody, raise your hand. One person. I've had to do it. And Tim met the guy at camp. He's on fire for God. The best thing we ever did, he would not take care of his family. He literally moved out into his RV and had them turned off the electricity, the water, everything, and his family was in their house starving and had no electricity because he felt like his wife was spending too much money. And so I confronted him, didn't want to hear it, brought back an elder, didn't want to hear it. So we got in front of the whole church and said, we love this brother, but he cannot fellowship anymore until he repents. And do you know, 3 months later, he's back in my office weeping, saying, please forgive me, because you know what? You can't live in sin and enjoy fellowship at the same time. Amen? And too often we have churches that are making people think it's okay for you to sleep around. It's okay for you to be doing drugs every day. It's okay for you to do this and live this lifestyle and act contrary to the word of God. It's no big deal. Guys, it's a big deal. Now we're all, who sinned this week? I'm not talking about only sinless people could be here because no one would be here. But what I'm talking about is people living in open defiance against the word of God, in open rebellion and refusing to repent and acting like it's okay. You know how you know you're walking with God? Is you hate your sin. Amen? It grieves you. Nobody has to tell you, hey, don't do that. You're like, I want nothing to do it. When you do it, it's just 2 seconds later. You got the Holy Spirit head slap. Amen? You're grieved to the depths of your soul. You, Lord, help me. I pray that often. Anybody else? And so this picture, this javelin is thrown through because he says, I'm not going to let this happen. I'm not going to allow this to continue. This is not okay. If nobody's going to do anything, I'll do something. We'll talk about the significance of the javelin later. Verse 9. And those who died in the plague were 24,000. 24,000 people died because they chose to enter into sexual immorality, because they chose to go and worship a false god, and because of their allowing their flesh to rule in their lives, they missed out on the land of promise. They did the whole 40 years out in the wilderness and missed out on being in God's presence. Succumbing to the flesh and idol worship, so close and yet so far. You know what's interesting? It says 24,000 people died. Later, when we see the children of Israel numbered again, the Simeonites' number has dropped way down. And I have an idea. They followed the example of their leader. Amen? The guy who was leading them, they saw, you know, and I'll say this, my kids watch me for a cue, even now. Amen? People, you know, they'll see somebody do something and they'll look at dad. Is that okay? You know, how did dad respond? Right? And if the guy who's supposed to be the leader is living that way, guess everyone behind him is going to follow suit. This guy was one of the leaders in the Simeonite tribe, and when we get to the Simeonites again being numbered amongst the children of Israel, everybody else's number grew and theirs shrank. I wonder what happened right here. The leader falls, everyone falls. Guys, that's a message for every dad in the room. Amen? And every mom in the room, but it starts with dad. God's called you to be a spiritual leader. You set the example for your home. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Amen? And I don't want to get legalistic, but I'm going to just, look, if people are getting drunk in your house, something needs to change. Amen? If there's stuff on your television that you wouldn't watch with Jesus sitting next to you, something needs to change. Amen? If there's music being listened to, if things are being entertained, guys, how can we say we love God and then watch movies where they curse our Savior? Amen? I'm not trying to be legalistic. What I'm trying to say is, let's be a holy example and live that example out in front of others. Amen? Because those who lead will lead people toward the Lord or away from Him. Some of you, you could say, my dad did this, and I fell right into the same thing. Amen? My mom did this, and I went right after that same stuff. Lord, help us. Take an active role in having a home set apart to the Lord. Pray with your family. Have worship music on in your house. And you know what? Pastor Dave, just me, my conviction doesn't mean it's your conviction. It's my conviction. It's legalism when I tell you it should be yours. I listen 99% exclusively to only worship music. Because anything else I listen to, it doesn't have to. If you listen to the Beach Boys, it's not bad. Listening to something else, it's not going to kill you. But that being said, if I listen to music that's honoring to the Lord, it draws me into God's presence. It doesn't distract me from God's presence. And by the way, when I was a teenager, we had nothing. I wore out my Bob Dylan, Gotta Serve Somebody record. I had that Love Song and Mustard Seed Faith, and that was it. Now, man, you can listen to every kind of music, whatever kind of music you like, there's godly music that honors him that's good. Amen? And so, I'm telling you, and by the way, I bought a car with 17 speakers because I love to worship God. Amen? Anybody been in my car, your ears are still ringing. Amen? I play my Toby Mac at full Mach 2, okay? But guys, if we're going to do it, let's do what honors God and draws us closer to the Lord, not draws us away from him. Amen? Again, filter the internet, movie. Don't be unequally yoked with unbelievers. Set those examples. Look at verse 10. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, Phinehas, the son of Eleazar, the son of Aaron, the priest, has turned back my wrath from the children of Israel, because he was zealous with my zeal among them, so that I did not consume the children of Israel in my zeal. Therefore, say, behold, I give to him my covenant of peace, and it shall be to him and his descendants after him a covenant of everlasting priesthood, because he was zealous for his God and made atonement for the children of Israel. Because this man stood up for the things of God, because he refused to turn a blind eye to sinful behavior, because he stood up for the things of God when nobody else would, God says, I'm going to bless him and the generations that come after him forever. What a promise, amen? We need to stand up for the truth, amen? Not water down the word of God, so I might hurt someone's feelings. If I'm sinning, hurt my feelings, amen? Please. Better to cut off your right hand, right, than spend eternity burning in hell. Pluck out my right eye. Whatever it takes to live holy and set apart unto the Lord. Phinehas was not condemned for what he did. He was blessed by God because this man walked into God's tabernacle. He walked amongst God's people, and he mocked the things of God. And somebody had to step up and say, that's not okay. Amen? It was rescuing others from the same fate. If that guy had moved in and been camping out and sleeping with that Midianite woman, how many more Midianite women do you think would have moved into the camp? The next day. They'd been bringing them all in there. But he stopped it by saying, it's not okay. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. It says in Psalm, then Phinehas stood up and intervened, and the plague was stopped, and that was accounted to him for righteousness to all generations forevermore. Look at verse 14 and 15. We get the names of the people who did this. Now the name of the Israelite who was killed with the Midianite woman was Zimri, the son of Salu, the leader of a father's house among the Simeonites. So he was a leader amongst the Simeonites. He was one of the examples. He was supposed to be an example to follow, and he was the one who had done this, so he was made an example of. Let not many of you be teachers. His name, Zimri, means remember me. I think he accomplished that. Not in a good way, amen? After tonight, most of you might remember his name forever. Zimri, that's the dude that got the javelin in the back. Amen? That's the guy that flaunted his sin in front of God's people. Didn't work out too well. Now, I think this is kind of tragic, but almost comical, because look at the name of the woman. Look what it says. And the name of the Midianite woman who was killed was Cosby. Cosby! Daughter of Bill! I'm kidding. The daughter of Zur. He is head of the people. He was head of the people of his father's house in Midian. So this was a woman of high stature amongst the Midianites, and he was a man of high stature amongst God's people, and they came together and they flaunted their sin amongst God's people, and God dealt with it. Her name means deception. So remember me connected with deception. And he's being remembered for falling into deception. Amen? And there are people who the enemy will use to deceive you and draw. But he's so nice. He's got a nice car. He's a nice guy. Is he on fire for God? If not, run away. Amen? Flee youthful lust. The enemy is not going to tempt you with something that doesn't please your flesh. I've told you this before. There's not a doubt in my wife that Potiphar's wife was a hottie. You know how I know that? First of all, the king doesn't marry ugly women. He can have whoever he wants. He's picking the pretty ones. And I know that she was a hottie because he had to run. Amen? She's grabbing his coat. Come lie with me. My husband's not around. He left his coat and ran away. If she was ugly, he'd have just, give me my coat. He would have just stood there. So what does the enemy tempt you with? He tempts you with that which your flesh wants. Amen? And he will try to draw you away with it. Their positions of prominence might have stopped the judges from executing judgment upon them, but it didn't stop Phinehas. He was zealous for the Lord, and he didn't care about a man's title. Okay, you're high up in the Midianites, and you're high up amongst us. Your title means nothing when you defy my God. Amen? There are people today, if you speak out against some of this nonsense coming out of the Catholic Church, don't talk bad about the Pope. Pope needs to repent. Pastor Dave, that wasn't very nice. Guys, I know anybody's got anybody kissing their ring needs to repent. We bow to Jesus and nobody else. Amen? The angels, people bow to angels. Get up! And if you're walking around having people worship you and honor you, and you've got to have bodyguards wherever you go, and I'm not just talking about the Pope, but all these guys, I have bodyguards and I'm in the ivory tower. You're a sinner in desperate need of a Savior, and you're supposed to be a servant. Amen? And he saw this, and he wasn't impressed, and where's the javelin? Finally, finish up, last few verses. Taking a stand for the truth, holiness before God. God suffers long, but he won't suffer always. Look at verse 16 through 18 as we finish up. Then the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, harass the Midianites and attack them, for they harassed you with their schemes, by which they seduced you in the matter of Peor, in the matter of Cozbi, the daughter of the leader of Midian, their sister who was killed in the day of the plague because of Peor. You notice that God remembers when the ungodly attack his people. When they entice his people, when they try to stumble his people. We know the story of the Amalekites, who when the children of Israel were marching through the wilderness, they would come and pick off the invalids and kill those who were straggling behind. And then God raised up Saul and said, go kill all the Amalekites a couple hundred years later. When we get to chapter 31, we're going to see the Midianites getting the judgment of God. Five chapters from now. If you're 5 weeks from tonight, you'll see it. And guess who one of the people that's going to die with the Midianites? Balaam. Amen. Balaam. Tried to curse God's people. Let's go bring the women into the camp. And when the Midianites go down, so is Balaam going to. So close and yet so far. He saw Jesus face to face. Jesus appeared to him, talked to him, instructed him. The Holy Spirit came upon him. And yet he still tried to entice. Now let me close with this. This is something God showed me in this text, and I pray that it ministers to you as much as it ministered to me. There's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. He's forgiven us. And we live in a different time by the grace of God. But I want you to notice something, that the judgment that came upon those who disobeyed God, who got caught up in harlotry, got caught up with the false gods, how were they judged? Let me remind you. First of all, their sin was dealt with and had to be dealt with so the fierce anger of God would turn away. The leaders were hung out in the sun as a public spectacle. How did your Savior die for you? Hung out in the sun as a public spectacle. And they were hung out in the sun as a public spectacle so the wrath of God might be turned away from God's people. And because Jesus hung out in the sun as a spectacle, the wrath of God was turned away from all of us. Amen? And as Jesus hung on the cross, they took something and stuck it in his side. Who remembers what it was? A spear or a javelin? Amen? Here's what I want us to see. The wrath of God had to be poured out to bring restoration, but Jesus took the wrath of God upon himself so that you and I might be restored. We're the ones who commit the sexual immorality. We're the ones who worship the false gods, the gods of money and career and power and whatever, and drugs or whatever that god becomes. And instead of us facing the consequences, Jesus took it for us. What a great and awesome God we serve. Amen? Thank you, Jesus. Amen? Numbers 25, it's pointing to Jesus. They suffered it because they deserve it. We deserve it, and he suffered it for us. Guys, if that doesn't get you excited about the God we serve, amen? What a great and awesome God. Sins paid for. So close and yet so far. May we not succumb to the sins of the flesh. May we walk in the Spirit that we do not fulfill the lusts of the flesh. May we take a stand for holiness and have the courage to rid the camp of evil if necessary. And guys, remember that we're new creations in Christ. May we walk in the power of the Holy Spirit. God suffers long, but he won't suffer always. Lord, help us to live holy lives. Amen? Heavenly Father, we love you. We praise you. We worship you, Lord. I thank you for everyone's patience tonight in this cold room. But Lord, I thank you for your word, and I thank you for just the privilege we have, Lord, to be together tonight, to hear from your word, to have your Holy Spirit minister to our hearts. If there's anybody here tonight that's living a life like Cosby and like Zumri, Lord, I pray that tonight they would repent. Pray for living lives that are direct defiance to your word, that, Lord, we would no longer feel comfortable in that. But, Lord, we would get right with you. Lord, we love you. We praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Let's stand and close with the doxology.